Yes, thank you very much. So welcome to this wonderful Qt on Embedded Linux talk. I'm Laszlo Agocs. I work in Oslo, Norway. And well, as some of you might know, well, I work on various areas in Qt. So this includes graphics, so you know, OpenGL enablers and whatnot. Then I also do quite a lot of embedded Linux stuff. And you know, some work on the input support, windowing system integrations here and there. And of course, I'm not limited to one platform. So even though this talk is about embedded Linux, well, I've been actually working on all sorts of systems, so desktop, mobile, embedded, everything. So everywhere where you need graphics and input. So the title of the talk, well, it's a bit long, and anyway, it doesn't really matter. So the real reason why we are here is to really take a look at the foundations of how we get something on the screen when running Qt applications and embedded Linux. And this is really important because, you know, many people or many teams when starting a project with Qt and embedded, they often, well, I'm saying this based on real life experiences, they will often run into the issues which we are going to cover here. What's worse, sometimes they run into these issues late in the project, which of course often results in panic and so on. So, yeah, I think it's definitely important to anyone who's doing embedded with Qt to, you know, just take a look how graphics and input is done. So after a very quick look at really what we mean by embedded here and how and why Qt is great and how Qt helps, we'll move on really to the area of graphics because that's usually the most important thing when getting started. And then we'll cover a bit like input, multimedia, and some software stack issues. So, first of all, the usual issue of the term embedded, because that's an overloaded term. So, to some people, embedded means something totally different. But for us, and hopefully for to most of you in this room, you know, embedded means typically some ARM, Intel, or MIPS-based, you know, device, system, or appliance. And we are often asked for minimum hardware specs, and you can see some there. Well, frankly, this doesn't mean much, because, you know, I could say that, yes, Qt needs a 500 megahertz CPU, but that means nothing because it depends what you are really targeting. So, you know, it might be good enough for some things. It will surely not be good enough for, say, running web engine. So, yeah. Similarly, for graphics, of course, we say that you absolutely need a GPU, like with OpenGL. Well, it's in parentheses because technically that's not quite true, because, as you know, we have some solutions for doing stuff without, without a GPU. And finally, the question of the low-end range. So when we move on to the area of microcontrollers, so ARM Cortex-M and similar stuff, that's currently out of scope, which is not, generally speaking, not fully true, because, you know, there used to be ports of Qt 4 running on such hardware. And as you might have heard during the keynote today, you know, Lars also mentioned that, of course, there is some research also in that area. But for now, we are interested in this. So here are 10 boards. Well, there's a special one on the lower left corner, which is only a module that needs a carrier board. The rest, all the others are complete boards. All of them are ARM-based, except there's one on the bottom, which is an Intel NUC. Well, of course, there are also boards with MIPS, so ARM is not the only choice. So yes, when we talk about Qt and embedded, we really mean running Qt stuff on on a board similar to these. So, say you have a board. Well, on that picture, that's a Raspberry Pi 2. And what do you want to do with it? So really, what do you want to build? Because this is not it. This is another thing. Because for many people, you know, they have different use cases. So it's one thing that, you know, you can run, you know, like a traditional windowing system like X11 and use it like a PC. That's totally awesome. But it's totally not what we are after. Because what you want is most likely something like this. So, you know, that's a cute quick application, full screen, with touch friendly, with visual effects, and so on, running smoothly at 60 FPS. And it's the traditional windowing paradigms from the desktop are just plain and simply irrelevant. Of course, going further, still QtQuick, this time is QtQuick controls, which is, you know, in some cases you might still need the traditional controls like buttons, checkboxes, whatnot. The nice thing here is that we do have it, and they are touch friendly. They will adapt to the screen size. And, you know, they look decent. On embedded, you have no native look and feel, so there are no native buttons. It's all up to you. Or if you are using a framework like Qt, then up to the framework to provide it. And it's there, which is awesome. Or again, something else, something completely custom, an old automotive IVI demo, again built with QtQuick, a totally custom user experience. And finally, when it comes really cool, is that when things like multimedia and or 3D are, you know, combined. So that's a Sabre board. And what you probably can't see is that, of course, there are some QtQuick controls there on the right side. So it's a QtQuick application. And we have the camera stream. Then we do some processing. Well, in this case, an external framework, like with the help of an external framework, like OpenCV. And the whole thing is, you know, working in harmony, you know, like in the QtQuick scene. And that's what's really powerful. The same goes for 3D. Think about, you know, 3D content, then the 2D user interface combined smoothly, easily. So, you know, if you are after something we just saw, then what's the problem without Qt? Well, you know, the usual things with getting started, like with cross-compilation. You know, you will probably have to cross-compile on your PC, like to produce ARM binaries. Or, of course, you need to fight with, what do I put on that device? Where does the system image, like, you know, that Linux image come from? Then you get to the problems or the questions regarding the windowing system that is X11, Wayland, or whatever available. Does it work? Is it fast enough? And so on. And as we saw in many cases, that's just an overkill. Because, you know, for a single full screen application, it's you just often don't need that. You often don't want that. Then I already talked about the user interface controls, that there's nothing native on embedded. So of course you need to draw your buttons yourself. And finally, even if you are fine with all these and say that, yes, you will, like, say, use OpenGL directly because it's easy, then you run into the problem of the board, or usually GPU vendor-specific solutions that are needed to get something on the screen, because like an interface like EGL is not enough. So usually there is some platform, vendor, board-specific glue. This is a, you know, some code which varies how complicated it is. It depends on the drivers and so on. And as hopefully many of you know, this is exactly why Qt is great and embedded, because it solves pretty but most of these things. Like in Qt 5, we have finally a proper platform abstraction layer, like the QPA. So we can port to new platforms or new windowing systems. So this will be very interesting because, as we'll see, like on embedded Linux, we have multiple platform plugins. So it's not as simple as on, say, desktop, where, you know, there's usually one for each operating system. And of course, not to mention the fact that, you know, it will often work out of the box for many boards, you know, because it has the board-specific integration. Then QtWS controls, you know, I mean, everybody knows it, that's great. Qt multimedia, again, accelerated video playback or getting, you know, the input from the camera. That's, you know, in a way that it properly integrates with QtWS, that's, you know, there. And again, the cross-compilation thingy is pretty well covered, we believe. You know, like the build system of Qt is pretty well prepared to handle this. And so, graphics. So, some platform plugins in Qt, and, you know, I just want to mention the names because this Linux FB, EGLFS, XAB, Wayland, so these. You know, it's just important for everyone to know. Even if you are a manager, you will still hear these words, you know, popping up all the time from developers. They will blame EGLFS that nothing works, which is, you know, usually not the case, but anyway. So, again, Linux FB. Well, I hope not many of you will use it. So this is the traditional software rendering only thing. So, you know, you just we write stuff directly so to a device like /dev/mp0. So this is still good enough for running widget, so traditional QWidget apps, or it's also good enough for the QtWS2D renderer, which is the solution for using QtWS without a GPU. However, you know, these are hopefully the, you know, less common. This is a less common case. What most of you will use is, of course, EGLFS, which is really the platform plugin to give you that gives you a full screen, you know, OpenGL window, so EGL, OpenGL, and then you can, you know, do whatever you want. Again, this is a full screen, so in this case, a single Qt application will own the screen, which is, you know, good enough in most cases. If not, because if you absolutely need to have like multiple processes rendering things, you know, concurrently, and then, you know, want to show them on the screen at the same time, then you need a windowing system, and that's where the other two come in, like XCB. Of course, you could use X11 if you wanted to on many embedded boards. And that's the XCB plugin, that's the exact same thing you have on desktop, like on desktop Linux. But in practice, or nowadays, you will increasingly more and more often will use Wayland, which is a more modern protocol for, you know, creating compositors, a protocol for talking between clients and the compositor. And yeah, that's what the Qt Wayland and Qt Compositor modules are about. No, there's a bullet point there, like this multiple backends for under all of these platform plugins. And that's important. So that's a recurring pattern here. Because, like I said, there are vendor platform-specific components in play. So it's one thing that we have a dynamically loaded platform plugin. But in all those three cases, since Qt 5.5 at least, the platform plugin will again load another plugin, which contains the, you know, hardware vendor-specific adaptation. Yes, we'll talk about that more when we get to the actual plugins. So, okay, you know, say you are in the, you know, the first or the beginning phase of your project, and you know you want to use Qt, you know, some things, then what's the first, you know, question really when planning the things? So does the device have a GPU? You know, some projects may go wrong at this stage because while it might be very tempting to save 2 cents on, you know, on a GPU, it is, you know, happens very often, that might actually have serious consequences because, yeah, if you don't have OpenGL, hardware accelerated graphics, then yes, you are stuck with QVidget or the somewhat limited QtWS2D renderer. You know, so the heavily animated, you know, UI with visual effects, that's, you know, not there. You can still do many things, but it's limited. So yeah, first thing to keep in mind. Okay, then, yeah, we talked already about windowing systems, so yes, will you have a windowing system on the board? And if yes, is it supported? What's more, you know, people may often overlook things like, oh, that, you know, like, say, OpenGL may not be available when running, you know, with a windowing system. So say, think of, I don't know, Raspberry Pi or something where, you know, you can run X11, but, you know, the OpenGL is not there. Well, at least if you are using the Broadcom's own drivers. Because, yeah, it's just not really supported in there. Or, in some cases, again, it depends what kind of really Linux image you are using, but in some cases, especially the traditional distros like to set up things in weird ways. So maybe you get a software rasterizer like Mesa LLVM pipe, because, you know, that works everywhere and it's good enough for Hello World type of applications. And, you know, you would think that everything will be fine, you know, when you run your QtOps on it, but, you know, that just won't perform. So you really need to make sure that you really have accelerated graphics available. Because if not, then you will have nasty surprises later in the project, which is not quite ideal. And then we get to the question of the backends. That, you know, I will use EGLFS or Wayland or something, and, you know, will it really work? Because, you know, you can't always assume that it will just work. And this is when famous error messages like, could not create EGL surface, blah. So this kind, so the application aborts with such an error when running on EGLFS. That's usually a sign of, you know, either a missing backend or the wrong backend or, yeah, something else. But it's usually the first two, one of the first two. Because, as you can see, you know, we have a bunch of backends, so these are literally plugins in Qt5.6 to EGLFS. And while in many cases it will just work because Qt will come with, you know, support for Vivanta GPUs, ARMoly GPUs, the Broadcom GPUs in Raspberry Pi, we have support for the direct rendering manager and kernel mode setting. You know, this is typical if you are using Mesa, say on an Intel-based device, also some other devices. We have some basic full-screen X11 support just in case, because, of course, you might have boards where X11 is the only option. You know, for some vendors, that's fine, but, yeah. Okay, in some cases, you don't need a backend, and my point here is that in some cases, you will need a new backend. Which is sometimes very easy, because it might be a few lines of code. So some of these is literally like 10 lines, whereas some others are hundreds. But just simply be aware that, you know, there are really platform specifics or, you know, board specifics in play here. Of course, needless to say, if it turns out that you absolutely need a new backend, then, you know, like our consulting services are happy to help you, but, yeah, that's, I guess, goes without saying. Actually, one more thing. And yes, so while this covers, you know, many of the popular boards, so as an example, we are also working on new stuff. So for example, the modern NVIDIA boards will need something different, and this is exciting because, you know, we've been working on this just before coming here, so that the DRM, KMS, GBM thing is not quite usable there because, you know, NVIDIA uses some different EGL extensions, so we need to deal with EGL device, EGL output, EGL stream. These are EGL extensions. And yeah, once we have that in place, then EGLFS will function also on these, you know, on these NVIDIA boards. So yeah, that's exciting new stuff. Coming, I don't know, maybe 5.6, maybe 5.7, let's see. Then we were talking about, you know, error messages. There's this other one, very popular one. They are not popular, but maybe the infamous one. The OpenGL windows cannot be mixed with others. You know, you are trying to either open a new QtWS window, either from C++, or using the window element in QtWS. Or you are simply using a combo box with quick controls, and you press on it, and the application dies. Well, this EGLFS. It might work with Wayland or XCB, like when you have a real windowing system with multiple window support. And frankly, this is perfectly fine, which of course probably won't help you. But this is the case when the application design also has to be aware of, you know, certain, well, let's call it limitations or features of an embedded system like this. Because EGLFS does not composite OpenGL windows. You are really expected to have a single full-screen window. We do it for QWidget because that's easy. You know, the traditional software render stuff, that's, yeah, we have some support for that. But with QtWS, this is something people really run into quite often. So what we are going to do here is that in the next generation QtWS controls, we will make sure that all controls work in all cases. So, you know, like a combo box and so on. But at the same time, you could argue that using menus, or so these desktop-ish menus and combo boxes and so on, it's kind of a broken idea in the first place, because that's, you know, that doesn't really suit a touch screen and so on. So again, this is something to take into account when designing the UI. Then another popular issue is with multiple displays. So some of the boards you have seen earlier allow you to hook up multiple displays. So maybe there's a touch screen, like a small one, that might also be a touch screen connected through LVDS. Then you might have an external, big external display connected through HDMI, and so on and so on. And of course, you might probably want to, you know, just render different things from the same, from a single Qt applications, render different things on different windows. Which, in theory, sounds easy. In practice, unembedded, well, it won't always work. Simply because, you know, again, the platform specifics are there that on some boards, we simply have no way to control this. So we can only support a single screen, because we just don't have APIs, really, to, you know, to manage, to enumerate, you know, the connectors and screens. In some other cases, we have limited support. So say on the IMX6, Freescale IMX6-based boards, we have the ability to choose which screen to output to, which is better than nothing. But right now, full support is only there when you use DRM and KMS, because that really has a proper API for, you know, managing and finding the connected screens. So yes, this is, again, something to keep in mind. And, you know, if this is really an issue, then this is something which you should take care of or somehow bring up early in the project and not late. Because otherwise, you know, you'll be having issues. And finally, you know, if you look at the spec sheet of a board, you might find that supports OpenGL ES, and that's all it tells you. Well, yeah, that's important information, but in itself, that's doesn't really guarantee much, because it doesn't mean that your QtWS applications will really perform smoothly with a low, CPU GPU overhead. It will run at 60 FPS with proper, vSync, so that everything is smooth. Because we have seen, unfortunately, real life examples of this, that some boards have components, like say the GPU, SoC, and the board coming from multiple vendors, who may all be interested in different things. They have different priorities. So we have seen cases that Qt applications were running more or less, but like at 20 FPS instead of 60, without vSync, with maximal CPU usage. And this was due to some lacking integration between like the EGL implementation and the display driver, so really the low-level components, because those were coming from two different entities who don't necessarily talk to each other that much. So here, the point is that you should see things in action. So if you want to be sure that things will perform, then you have to try it out, in real, to see the board, running, Qt or other, or this is not Qt related, or other OpenGL stuff with a, proper performance. Then, we should talk about Wayland, the multiprocess case, but frankly, this is nothing new after all these, because again, same old story. You need to ensure that it's supported. You have to have driver support, and hopefully that's a properly supported thing, so not some experimental proof of concept solution. Well, today the situation is getting much better, so yeah, Wayland works fine on many boards. And again, the issue of multiple backends, surprise, surprise. So this time it's a bit different because this is about the buffer sharing mechanism. So, how do you share the rendering between the compositor process, which owns the screen? So this might be a Qt applications running on EGLFS, for example. So how do you share your rendering between that process and the individual processes running with the Wayland platform plugin, which actually produce that output. And in most cases, the first one is fine, but like that second Broadcom one, that's for the Raspberry Pi, that's a good example that in some cases, we have a custom one, simply because that was the only way to, using some Broadcom-specific APIs, it works fine, but still it needs a different backend because we can't use the first one. And again, this is why if your spec sheet says Wayland is supported, that does not guarantee 100% that your Qt-based compositor and Qt, and then the Qt applications, will really work. And unfortunately, we have seen this again, that if you are really testing your systems, say on a desktop, Qt is great, it's cross-platform, or you are only testing, say, with Veston, which is the reference Wayland compositor, instead of using, the Qt compositor thingy. So then, of course, there's a chance that you simply don't discover that, that particular board driver will not really be functional. And we have seen that in some cases that gets discovered late in a project, and then there are panic and everything. And like I said, the problem with Veston is that of course the vendors will often make sure that there is a patched version available in the system image or wherever for the board. wherever that's coming from. But again, that doesn't mean that those patches are present in all the other Wayland compositors, you know, which in our case means Qt. So again, like the NVIDIA case is a good example. So again, that's also something we are working on, that there we have to use EGL streams, so a different way to share stuff between processes. So, you know, otherwise things don't work out of the box. Input. Well, you know, graphics was, you know, our most important topic. But the thing with graphics, it has some good sides because it either works or it doesn't work, and you know, there's no middle way. Whereas in input, you know, we will unfortunately have to deal with some new possible issues. So if we are running on a windowing system, then yeah, Qt's life is relatively easy, since then it's up to that to really, you know, get events from the input devices and, you know, somehow abstract all the input stuff. And generally, that's in good shape. Although, if those of you who have followed the development of the Qt 5 series have probably noticed that 5.0 had, you know, serious issues, or it lagged in the area of, for example, multi-touch, so touch events, or the pen-based tablet support was pretty, well, incomplete or non-existent, for example, on X11. But the nice thing here is that today, you know, thanks to a lot of contributions, also from inside and outside the Qt company, it works pretty well. So, you know, multi-touch, of course, mouse, keyboard, pen-based tablet support is generally in good shape. Then, what's probably more interesting to us on embedded is the case without a windowing system, because then it's either up to Qt to, you know, directly open, say, /dev/input/event something and read events, or of course we might want to use an external third-party library. So the bottom three, like this EVDev keyboard, mouse, touch, so these are the traditional input, let's say, handlers in Qt, which are, you know, working fine in most cases. But one of the new things in 5.5 was that we introduced support for libinput, which is an input handling library forked out of Weston. And in 5.6, actually, this is the default, if it's available, you know, when building Qt. And, you know, this is going to be great because in the future we might get a similar, you know, behaviors, you know, between like Weston, other Wayland compositors, possibly Xorg, and even Qt applications running without a windowing system, you know, behavior when it comes to pointer acceleration and all kinds of things. But, so what did I just say? That yes, it's enabled if it's present. So really, here the dependencies matter, because for graphics it works or it doesn't work, but in input, there are cases when you will have, say, input support, but suddenly you find that, oh, when I connect a USB mouse, for example, for, I don't know, development purposes, then it doesn't pick that mouse up because my Qt application is already running. And of course, usually, you know, then bug reports get created to Qt, which are, of course, all, well, not of course, but most of, in most cases, those are invalid, because what happens is that then, you know, Qt was simply configured without, like, libudev support. Because, you know, when somebody runs a configure script, you know, before really building Qt, there are these optional dependencies which either get picked up, and then it's fine, or they are not there, and then the corresponding feature gets disabled. So, for example, this hot plugging for, you know, mouse, keyboard, and so on is one of these. Or, like, the libinput support is similar, that, you know, if the headers and libraries were not there when building Qt, then, you know, in the resulting Qt libraries, the support will be disabled. And again, this might be difficult to discover when you are just getting started with Qt and embedded. So, you know, just keep in mind that, you know, dependencies and the configuration of Qt matters. Then, two more things. Because those of you who are using these single-touch resistive touchscreens, which are very common in, say, industrial environments, again, the thing to note that, yes, we have support for that, but you might need to do some minor extra steps to really enable it, because this is a special case. Because when we say touch in Qt, we are thinking of multi-touch, and not this kind of, you know, single-touch thing, which really corresponds to mouse events. So, you know, this can usually be enabled with like an environment variable or something that's usually documented in our, on our embedded Linux page. So it's not exactly rocket science, but you have to be aware that if you have such a screen, then you might, you know, need this backend. And finally, for input, voice. Yes, just in case you didn't know, in Qt 5.6, we have the tech preview of the Qt speech module, which, you know, I think it might become relevant also for all sorts of embedded use cases. So yeah, let's see how this evolves, but I guess talking to your embedded board is fun, or, you know, it might become a common way to control these, you know, whatever devices you are building. Multimedia, well, this is going to be very simple, because the main message here is that, one, you need hardware-accelerated video decoding through GStreamer. So if that's not there, then, you know, forget about it. At least Qt Multimedia is really built on GStreamer. What's more, you should really have GStreamer 1.0 support. Yeah, because the old O10 support is still there, but in 5.6, that's, you know, not even enabled by default, so we prefer 1.0 now, if both are present. And, you know, it's counting on software decoding is just not going to fly on most of these boards. So, you know, they are just not strong enough or powerful enough to manage, you know, software decoding. So, you know, hardware acceleration is, you know, just has to be there. The other thing is that, yes, in some cases, getting Qt Multimedia running in an environment which, you know, wasn't previously tried, that might be tricky because, you know, it has certain requirements for GStreamer and so on. So here, you know, if you are not prepared to deal with it, then you should really just choose a board, you know, a system where it's known to work. So I don't know, say, again, the IMX6 boards have, you know, good support. We know that both accelerated video decoding and camera support is there, so it will usually just work. Whereas on an other unknown board, who knows? And finally, software stack. I won't really go into the details here, because actually there's a session just after this one, probably in the same room. It's Andy's talk about Qt for device creation, which is, you know, can be seen as a continuation of this talk. And it will be more about the software stack. So our main point here is that, first of all, getting your, you know, system images, so the image which is flashed on a memory card or directly on the device. So just to get, so in many cases it might be sufficient, you know, get any image from somewhere and use that because it's good enough to get started. But later in the project, you know, this typically becomes very cumbersome because what if you then need to add a new library there? And what's more, you will, of course, need the headers and ARM libraries locally on, on each and every developer's PC in the sysroot because you are cross-compiling. So it's, you know, it gets pretty messy. And that's why, in generally, you know, we recommend to use a distro generation tool, a system like Yocto or Buildroot, where you can, by running some simple commands, you can generate like a system image and a corresponding SDK, which of course includes the toolchain, so the GCC or whatever, the cross compilers, and the sysroot containing the headers and libraries. And of course, if you add something new, like say you, it turns out that, oh, libudev is missing and Qt needs it, then you can just, you know, add it and then build a new image, build a new SDK, and, you know, then everyone in the team can use it. Because now you have an easy way to reproducibly create images and SDKs. What's the catch? The catch is that, you know, do you have the recipes for your board, you know, which allow you really to build an image which works on that particular board? And this is why, again, something you need to verify at the start of the project, that is there an actively maintained official Yocto layer available for the board? Because, you know, some boards have it, some don't, some have experimental ones, and, you know, which may or may not work. So, again, this is something to, you know, confirm, verify early enough. And the final thing is the question of Qt. Again, I think this was mentioned in the, very briefly mentioned in the keynote of Lars, that, you know, when it comes to these systems like Yocto and Buildroot, of course they have some level of Qt support, but traditionally these have been all unofficial, because really the official way to build Qt is to run the configure script, you know, do make, and then deploy the binaries in any way you want. Whereas, you know, things like MetaQt 5, the Yocto recipes for build up, for building Qt were, you know, were kind of unofficial and in an unknown state. So the good thing here is that this is, you know, this area is now getting more focus simply because, you know, systems like Yocto are very important to most of the embedded users. So, for example, yes, we'll need to, you know, work, and there has already been some work done, like to make, you know, like MetaQt 5 really the, you know, like a proper official way to get Qt in your image and your SDKs. Because, you know, the danger, I mean, we talked about this earlier, that if you just have a Qt build in an unknown configuration, who knows, maybe some things were not present in the sysroot when that build was done, then, you know, you might just not have some features. Or maybe some, you know, EGLFS backends are not there, and so on. And whoever did that build doesn't care, because they might only be interested in, say, X11. So, you know, you have to be careful here. So you need a proper Qt build, which is configured for your needs. So, to summarize, you know, the hardware, like the board, the drivers, you know, OpenGL, EGL implementation, or the display driver, the kernel stuff, then the software stack sitting above it, and your application design affect each other. So, you know, some component in this list may present a, you know, limitation or to the others. And really, you just need to, you know, contemplate and, you know, go through all of these early enough in your projects to make sure that everything will work together properly. And, you know, as smart people have said it before, you need to test early, test often. What's more, you need to test on the actual board, and, you know, these really the Qt-based application and components, and not, you know, of course you can develop big parts on your desktop PC or whatever, because Qt makes it easy since it's cross-platform. But still, you need to see things in action early enough, you know, to verify, to confirm that everything will work as you expect it to work. Yes, so that was all. I guess we now have quite a lot of time for questions, which is good, I think. So. Yeah. So.
Is there a mic for?
Yes, so there's a question there. I don't know. Or you can just say and I can repeat it.
Regarding the last slide, you say test, test, test with Qt. My question would be, is there some test suite available that you can have Qt and say, I want to dedicatedly test something like graphics performance, graphics stability, or I want to test the windowing interaction, I want to test user input. So is there some kind of a test suite available for this?
Not really, so there's definitely no full suite. Well, because, of course, these problems usually, you know, are apparent even when running, you know, very simple examples. So, you know, like any basic Qt example, like, you know, or Qt or Qt Quick, or in some cases even some non-Qt OpenGL applications will actually expose the problems. But no, so at the moment there is no full suite. So the expectation is that you will just, you know, run either some examples that come with Qt or maybe some of your existing applications.
I want to hit on the same topic. I think that having in the wiki or some documentation a common collection of some benchmarks and examples so that it's much easier to compare the different offerings to other offerings. So that you know much earlier that you might have problems in some areas. Because currently, the current approach you are proposing, that takes weeks or months, and that's really risky, and especially those who want to first get into Qt, they will play on Qt, that at some later moment they will play.
Yeah, in some cases. I mean, of course, it depends, right? Because, of course, there are, you know, like, really known good boards. Or, of course, this is why we also have also shipping, there are the reference images that come with Qt for device creation, which are then kind of guaranteed to work. But yes, it's still a problem in some cases. So, yeah, let's see what the future brings. So the idea, for example, really like a simple benchmarking suite that came up also in the past, you know, because you know, that would be helpful, you know, to know that you can expect this on this particular board, for example. So yes, that's, you know, something we are aware of. So, yeah, let's see.
Yes? My question is, you told us to use Yocto to do reproducible builds and sysroots and so on, but then you said that the official way to compile is configure main install, and that is it conflicts with the way you do
yes exactly. I mean,
how do you fix it? What's your experience?
Yes, so the Yocto story. Yes, I mean exactly, because that's why I said that. So the having Qt, you know, built properly inside Yocto, that's why this area is getting more and more important. Because yeah, it's true that, for example, what we've been doing in Qt for device creation, it's exactly that okay, we have the Yocto generated image SDK, and then Qt gets built kind of manually and then deployed on top. But yes, this is exactly why I guess in the future, you know, we'll kind of move away from this. So that's why hopefully, you know, MetaQt 5 or whatever, the Qt recipes in Yocto will really be the, you know, the way to build Qt. So yes, currently, of course, we recognize that there are some conflicts in the story. And that's why Yocto is getting more and more focus. Yes?
Can you say roughly what percentage difference between the 2D render and having acceleration is? Is it half as fast? Or, and then the other question is there a list of the things that aren't supported on 2D rendering? For example, are some controls not supported? Mm.
Well, so the 2D renderer performance. So first of all, the main thing is the screen resolution, because you know that if you have a higher resolution, like say full HD, well, frankly, the thing won't perform. But if you have a low resolution screen with more or less static content, so again, the amount of animations that matters, then who knows, maybe you won't notice. If you have a more static UI, you might not even notice the difference. But once you start to transform and animate, animate text and do all sorts of transformations, well, then it will immediately become apparent that, you know, it's just limited.
If during continuous integration you also have the operating system changing, you know, maybe a new Linux kernel or something else changed, do you think that we should, as best practice, always run the QtLib unit tests on the new Linux? Or maybe before trying our Qt application on the new hardware, should we run all the unit tests? And maybe part of the QPA drivers, do they come also with unit tests that can be run against the hardware?
Yes. So. Yes, there's actually work ongoing. So if you are thinking of the Qt CI infrastructure, there was and still is work ongoing to have like the unit tests running on an actual board. So that's work in progress. Because right now, I don't know, without those changes, you probably have difficulties with running the full unit test suite on an embedded board, because you know you'll encounter all sorts of issues. But yes, eventually we'll get there. So we really want to see the ability, you know, to both in our CI systems and also to all individuals. So the ability to run that full test suite on an actual embedded board, an embedded device. But at the same time, it's, you know, when it comes to, I mean, well, yes, there are unit tests tests. Auto tests, which are testing, you know, graphic stuff. So it is covered to some extent, but yeah, still I wouldn't call running the auto tests, you know, fully sufficient. So you still need to, you know, test things out separately, you know, when it comes to really graphics or input and those kind of things. So, yeah. And of course, that was a very good point with, of course, really this upgrading components. Again, that's something just, you know, which you should be careful with. Same applies to Yocto, that, you know, upgrading to a newer Yocto release may cause unexpected issues. So, in our experience, it's not that straightforward, because some things will usually get broken. So you can do that early in the project, but then maybe you want to stick, you know, to a given version release of the components. Yes?
I'm interested in your new product, Qt for device creation.
Mm-hmm.
Do you cater for the special life cycle needs for embedded projects? The typical case is that, for example, embedded project, when you do the development, you have finished it, you want to produce it for 6 years or 8 years.
Mm-hmm.
And are you prepared to support that?
Well, so Qt 5.6 is a long-term release. That's a basic answer, but yeah, I can't really comment on that, but that's a perfect question for the next session, which is about Qt for device creation. But yeah, I can't really answer that. So to, you know, providing support for that long, that's, yeah, a bit of unknown to me. Well, it's probably, you know, doable, like, you know, if you have those kind of agreements in place with the company. But yeah, it really depends case by case. So
Chris.
I noticed that you didn't mention DirectFB in your QPAs event. Is that just a mission, or is that should we be using DirectFB as backend for OpenGL?
Oh yeah, so DirectFB. Well, yeah, no, so DirectFB is another option. So we saw these four platform plugins, so DirectFB could be the fifth option, which is, well, so it's not listed there because, okay, that has limited interest. So if you have a board where you know that DirectFB is supported, then that's an alternative to LinuxFB, because with DirectFB we can have some 2D operations like Blitz or some transforms accelerated. So that can be a good candidate for running the QtQuick 2D renderer and, you know, still maintaining some level of hardware acceleration. The problem is that, yes, of course, it needs DirectFB support, and it needs good DirectFB support, because, you know, we have seen cases when, you know, using DirectFB resulted in worse performance than running with LinuxFB, which is a bit interesting, but... So yeah, it depends. It can be an option in some cases, but yeah, it's not something I would, you know, just recommend blindly. If it works for you, then fine. Basically, that's the answer. There, maybe the last question.
When you say good DirectFB support, of course, good is something that you have to define, you know, like a checklist. And as I understood, Lars said that they will also lobby for new C++ 11, 14, 16 features. So are you lobbying also for device manufacturers to follow your checklist in order for them to provide QT?
Well, yes, so I mean, in this area, not really, because of course we are mostly after the proper GPU cases. So I mean, EGL and OpenGL ES is what we are really after, and of course that's usually well supported. So, yeah, at least like in the DirectFB area, there's nothing special going on from our side. So, yeah.
Yeah.
But in general, so of course, yes, like, you know, we are, say, partnering even with some of these vendors. So yes, there is discussion. Of course, you know, how much influence Qt can have on these things, so like the GPU drivers, well, honestly, that's very limited. So there's, you know, yeah, the possibilities are limited. But there is discussion, so at least. Between the parties involved, that's something. Okay, I guess that's all.